Good morning. This is Radio Good News. The goal of this program is to draw all people to the love of Jesus Christ. I want everyone to know and experience the fruit of the Holy Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Those are key to a Holy Spirit-filled and successful Christian life. I will focus on God's love because God's love is wonderful. I'm John Thornton. I will be reading from the Bible, the New Revised Standard Version, because that is God's word to us in our modern language. Let's begin today with Psalm 118, verses 1 through 14. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his steadfast love endures forever. Out of my distress, I called on the Lord. The Lord answered me and set me in a broad place. With the Lord on my side, I do not fear. What can mortals do to me? The Lord is on my side to help me. I shall look in triumph on those who hate me. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to put confidence in mortals. It is better to take refuge in the Lord than to put confidence in princes. All nations surrounded me. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me on every side. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. They surrounded me like bees. They blazed like a fire of thorns. In the name of the Lord, I cut them off. I was pushed hard so that I was falling, but the Lord helped me. The Lord is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation. Those are God's words from Psalm 118, verses 1 through 14. Our musical guest today is Rebecca St. James.
Together is the way it should.
That was Rebecca St. James. We'll hear from her again at the end of the program. Turn with me, if you can, to 1 Peter chapter 4. Since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same intention. For whoever has suffered in the flesh has finished with sin, so as to live for the rest of your earthly life no longer by human desires, but by the will of God. You have already spent enough time in doing what the Gentiles like to do, living in licentiousness, passions, drunkenness, revels, carousing, and lawless idolatry. They are surprised that you no longer join them in the same excesses of dissipation, and so they blaspheme, but they will have to give an accounting to him who stands ready to judge the living and the dead. For this is the reason the gospel was proclaimed even to the dead, so that though they had been judged in the flesh, as everyone is judged, they might live in the spirit as God does. The end of all things is near. Therefore be serious and discipline yourselves for the sake of your prayers. Above all, maintain constant love for one another, for love covers a multitude of sins. Be hospitable to one another without complaining. Like good stewards of the manifold grace of God, serve one another with whatever gift each of you has received. Whoever speaks must do so as one speaking the very words of God. Whoever serves must do so with the strength that God supplies, so that God may be glorified in all things through Jesus Christ. To him belong the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. Beloved, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that is taking place among you to test you, as though something strange were happening to you, but rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, a criminal, or even as a mischief maker. Yet, if any of you suffers as a Christian, do not consider it a disgrace, but glorify God because you bear this name. For the time has come for judgment to begin with the household of God. If it begins with us, what will be the end for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And if it is hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinners? Therefore, let those suffering in accordance with God's will, Creator, while continuing to do good. Those are God's words from 1 Peter chapter 4. There's an old legend of two homeless men meeting at the bank of a river. One man was very, very hungry, and he was busy digging about looking for fishing worms to catch his supper. And for a few moments, the hungry man viewed the other man in wonder, and then inquired, "Where are you going?" "I'm going to heaven," replied the man, revealing that he was a Christian. "And where is heaven?" asked the hungry man. "Heaven," said the Christian as he sat down on the bank of the river, "is the best place of love. It is being with our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ for all eternity. It has wondrous streets of gold, gates and walls made of precious stones, and a beautiful river. In fact, it is the river of life and is as pure as crystal. The trees on the bank of that great river have leaves for the healing of the nations." The hungry man seemed rather unimpressed, but he continued digging for fishing worms. The Christian just sat down on the side of the river and stared into the sky. Finally, the hungry man said, "Are there any fishing worms in your heaven?" "Oh, of course there's no fishing worms in heaven," said the Christian man. "Well, I guess then that heaven is not much good to me, because I want some fishing worms so I can catch my supper." Often people will be so preoccupied with their urgent needs that they will forget about what are truly important needs. In 1 Peter chapter 4, God tells us through the Apostle Peter that we need to be genuine Christians, Christians who are known to the world as real Christians, rather than just a person who's after the next worm. And real Christians will help meet the needs of others, rather than just offering some empty pie in the sky, by and by wistful longing for heaven. A while back, I was reading former President Jimmy Carter's book, Living Faith, In President Carter's book, he recalls how some 40 years ago, he heard a sermon where the pastor asked, "If you were arrested for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you?" What a profound thought. So let us look in 1 Peter chapter 4 for what would be compelling evidence of being a Christian. I believe that Peter is trying to tell us how to make sure that we are truly living as followers of Jesus Christ. God wants us to be living lives that demonstrate faith in deeds as well as words. Peter says in verse 2 that we must live our earthly lives no longer by human desires, but by the will of God. We must not chase after the worms and worries of the world. Rather, let us set our hearts on living as followers of Jesus Christ. So as we look for evidence of Christianity, I believe that we could get a conviction if we found three solid proofs. Peter tells us that as true Christians, we will demonstrate three things. First, we will confess our sins and reject living in sin. Second, we will be obedient to Christ in showing love to all other people. And third, we will be faithful even in the midst of terrible suffering, for we all will suffer. If a person lives a life which demonstrates all three of those areas, then the evidence would rule for a conviction on that person being a Christian. By rejecting sin, we Christians will be truly obedient to Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul echoes Peter's teaching. In Romans 6, verse 5, we read, "For if we have been united with Jesus in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be destroyed, and we might no longer be enslaved to sin." Peter tells us that we have already spent enough time doing bad stuff. He gives us a brief list of sins. Have you noticed how much God likes lists? Throughout the Bible, God gives us lists of things to avoid. Peter tells us to avoid living in licentiousness, passions, drunkenness, revels, carousing, and lawless idolatry. Yes, those are things to avoid. In a Sunday school class, little Amy was busy listening to her teacher. Her teacher explained that God is loving and how Jesus is so compassionate that he will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness when we confess our sins. The teacher asked her class, "So class, what must we do before we can be forgiven for our sins?" Amy responded and said, "Well, teacher, it seems to me that first we gotta sin." We all will sin. There really is not any chance of us avoiding sin, is there? I know that I am a sinner. I sin in my thoughts, words, and deeds. We all are sinners. But Jesus is indeed compassionate and faithful, so as to forgive our sins when we confess. We know that some might claim that they are not sinners. Yes, there are always those people who are quick to point out others' sins, but never look at their own. Those type of people are some of the most lost. It is a simple matter to scream about others' sins while ignoring your own. Our Master Jesus said in Matthew 7, verse 3, "Why do you seek the speck in your neighbor's eye, but do not notice the log in your own eye?" The Apostle John tells us in 1 John 1:10, "If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us." So indeed, knowing our own sins and confessing them and asking God's forgiveness shows us to be Christians. So exhibit one, in the case of proving a Christian is a real Christian, is the evidence that that person confesses and rejects sin that he or she has committed. Do you confess and reject your sins? In verse 7, Peter says that the end of all things is near. Even 1,940 some years ago, Peter realized that we are living in the last days, and Peter tells us to discipline ourselves. Self-discipline is a fruit of the Holy Spirit, and Peter says that to be self-disciplined, we will show and maintain constant love for one another, for love covers a multitude of sins. But it is hard to love. This same teaching is found in the Old Testament. In Proverbs 10, 11 through 12, we read, "The mouth of the righteous is a fountain of life, but the mouth of the wicked conceals violence. Hatred stirs up strife, but love covers all offenses." Love is a universally strong attraction. Even in the animal world, we see love working to attract and uplift. A great minister of the 19th century, Dr. William Arnott, told his congregation the truth about love. He said that when he was on his father's farm, he would often watch his father teach young calves to drink milk. His father would dip his finger into the milk and then put it gently into the calf's mouth. Slowly, he would repeat this over and over. Soon, the calf would be drinking milk all by itself. Dr. Arnott related how similar this is to helping people to know Jesus' love. He said, "If you want to win people to Christ, you must go lovingly to them and lead them gradually to Him. If you do not show love for others, you need not even talk to them. For to show them Jesus is to show them love." Peter says that we must be hospitable toward each other. We must serve each other with whatever spiritual gift God has empowered us to use. Peter discusses two spiritual gifts, speaking and serving. But the Bible says that there are many other spiritual gifts, each to be used for the building up of the body of believers. And as we saw in Proverbs, violence is a terrible sin that robs the body of Christ and disrupts the use of spiritual gifts. Peter learned about how violence is not the mark of being a Christian, or a child of God, or a follower of Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace. When Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane and the armed detachment came to arrest him, Peter responded in a worldly manner. Peter drew out his sword and defended Jesus Christ. Peter attempted to start a violent conflict that he thought would be justified. After all, he was defending an innocent man, Jesus. So Peter whips out his weapon of destruction and chops down on the man Malchus, the servant of the corrupt high priest. Peter struck the man so violently that his ear was severed from his head. It may have nearly decapitated the man, so violent was that stroke. But Jesus commanded, "Oh, no more of this," and told his followers to forever put away your swords, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Oh, how we need to follow that command, and our world needs to put away our weapons and be real followers of Jesus Christ, showing love to others. For Jesus showed an example of love, incredible love. Jesus Christ, in loving kindness, then reached out to this man who was struck down. Jesus touched Malchus and healed his head by miraculously reattaching the man's ear. Peter saw Jesus perform this loving miracle. Jesus demonstrated in his actions what he had been teaching. Jesus showed love even for his enemies and did good to those who were ready to abuse him. Yes, indeed, our Savior Jesus Christ wants people to demonstrate love and compassion in all that we do. So exhibit two in the case of proving a Christian is a Christian is the evidence that the Christian demonstrates love to all other people. Love must be shown in good deeds toward our fellow Christians, family members, all our neighbors, and even toward our enemies. For a true Christian will know that love covers a multitude of sins. Do you show love to everyone as Jesus expects you to do? Peter tells us that suffering will happen. Suffering for what we do bad and suffering for what we do that's good. In verse 12, Peter writes of the fiery ordeal that his readers have been going through. Peter is referring to real flames and real persecution. Peter wrote this letter about the year 60 AD. At that time, Nero was emperor and was rather evil and terrible in what he did. He was especially violent toward Christians. The Roman Empire would later have dominion-wide persecutions, but Nero was no slouch in his ability to be cruel. The ancient historian Tacitus tells us what Nero did to Christian people. The Christians were killed by methods of mockery. They were torn apart by dogs. They were crucified, and they were set ablaze to light Nero's gardens by the night. Nero is also rumored to have burned down his own city of Rome. He may have set fire to the city and burned it down so he could rebuild it as he desired. But historically, we know that the Christians were blamed for that fire. So here Peter is saying to Christians to not be surprised by a fiery ordeal that they might be enduring. Peter writes, "But rejoice insofar as you are sharing Christ's sufferings, so that you may also be glad and shout for joy when his glory is revealed. If you are reviled for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory, which is the Spirit of God, is resting on you." Peter, is remembering what happened to Jesus Christ. If it can happen to the master, it certainly can happen to followers. For Jesus died on the cross. After Jesus was arrested, he was severely beaten and whipped and cursed and abused in all manner of vile ways. Jesus was then forced to carry that heavy cross through the streets. He fell exhausted under that weight, and an African man, Simon of Cyrene, carried the cross the rest of the way. Then Jesus was nailed hand and foot to the cross and tortured to death. What horrible suffering. But even in the middle of that suffering, far beyond anything we can imagine, Jesus showed love. Jesus looked at his abusers and said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." God wants Christians to act as Jesus did. Peter tells us in 1 Peter 3:9, "Do not repay evil for evil or abuse for abuse, but on the contrary, repay with a blessing. It is for this that you were called, that you might inherit a blessing." And again, we see Peter referring back to the book of Proverbs. In Proverbs 17:13, we read, "Evil will not depart from the house of one who returns evil for evil." And in Proverbs 20:22, we read, "Do not say, 'I will repay evil.' Wait for the Lord, and he will help you." God also inspired Paul to teach these same kind of Christian values. In Romans 12:14, we read, "Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them." And in Romans 12:17, "Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all." And God tells us never to be violent when he tells us in Romans 12:19-20, "Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, 'Vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord.' If your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink." And later in verse 21, we read, "Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." So we see that even when terrible suffering happens, and it can happen in each of our lives, a Christian will not engage in evil deeds. There is never a justification for resorting to evil. Peter tells Christians to expect suffering, but that a Christian must never meet evil by evil or respond with violence. Peter says, "If any of you suffers as a Christian, do not consider it a disgrace, but glorify God because you bear this name." And Peter lived out this to the very end of his own life. Tradition tells us that Peter was arrested and executed for his faith. Peter was crucified because he was a Christian in about the year 66 AD. Not all suffering is a result of evil persecution. Peter warns Christians to be honorable people of integrity and to reject sin. Peter writes in verse 15, "Let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, a criminal, or even as a mischief maker." Yes, far too often we've done evil deeds, myself included, and we put some kind of justification on it. But it is still sin, and sin hurts. Evil deeds will result in negative consequences. Exhibit 3, in the case of proving a Christian is a Christian, is the evidence that the Christian endures suffering without resorting to evil. So do you endure suffering without inflicting evil on others? It's a mark of being a Christian. So let us come back to that question that has been so important for former President Jimmy Carter. If you were arrested for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? Do you demonstrate that you are a real Christian? A Christian who lived out the kind of life God commands to us in the Bible was St. Francis of Assisi. He had a very hard and difficult life, but he was devoted to Jesus Christ and lovingly served the needs of others. He is a fine example that we should try to follow today. His famous prayer, the prayer of St. Francis, is as follows. "Lord Jesus Christ, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, let me sow pardon. Where there is despair, let me sow faith. Where there is darkness, let me sow light. Where there is sadness, let me sow joy. For it is in the giving that we receive. It is in the pardoning that we are pardoned. And it is in the dying that we are born to eternal life." I am John Thornton. Thank you very much for listening to Radio Good News. I encourage you to seek out a church family where you can worship, be encouraged, and get through the suffering and hard times each of us will have to go through. For this area offers many fine Bible-believing and teaching churches of various denominations. You can write to me at Radio Good News, P.O. Box 1722, Sioux Falls, South Dakota, 57101. And just this last week, on one day alone, I received 42 letters from Ghana, where we've been sending New Testaments and copies of some of these messages. May you richly know the blessings of the God who was, the God who is, and the God who is to come again. And always remember, the Bible says that love is patient, love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. Love does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. Love does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, and endures all things. Love never ends. So love Jesus Christ our Lord with all your heart, strength, soul, and mind, and love your neighbors as yourselves. We'll finish today with Rebecca St. James.
We are together.
We can stand together.
Side.
We are together.
We can stand together.
By side.